Good morning. Welcome, everyone. Let's stand together. So good to see you. Welcome. How is everyone? Well, we're glad you're here. This is a place where we come and we gather and we worship God in this place. And we profess with our tongues and our hearts that we follow Jesus and that we recognize him as King, those of us who have put our faith in him, in God's Son, and we recognize him as Messiah, and we've celebrated through the Easter season. But we get to come here and we also get to fellowship and we get to pray for one another and we get to think about the needs that are within a seat or two that are tremendous. So we've already had some heavy prayers this morning, some deep and hopeful prayers. So I hope that your hearts turn in that way as well, that you're opening yourself up already to what God has for you this morning and how you could be a blessing to those or to be blessed by those around you. So that's a good place to be, yes? There's not a lot of places in the world that are like that. Certainly the safety and freedom that we hold this morning is a gift, yes? Why don't you bow with me, and then I'll ask for God's blessing. God, we are so grateful for that. We're so grateful for being able to come to a place where we can freely worship you. Father in heaven, creator of all things, holder of the future, and holder of our moment now, we give ourselves over to you. God, humble us and ready us. Would you open our hearts to what you have? Would you make our spirits contrite and ready? God, you have so much for us. We need but ask, so we do that now. Fill us, Holy Spirit. Bless us, God, this morning as we praise you with our lips and our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's taste and see. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. Those who look on
Let us
your name together. Glorify the Lord with me. We exalt your name, God. We exalt your name forever.
All the hearts who are content. Yes, we will know that you are holy.
I'm going to sing a song. We've done this once before, but months ago, so it'll probably be new again for us, but it falls nicely in line with what we're trying to accomplish this morning as we open up James again and learn a bit about our place in God's world. Talks a bit about leaning not on our own understanding, climbing mountains with our hands wide open. Essentially, the song is called Nothing I Hold On To, and so it'll likely evoke something for each of us that's different based on what we're dealing with right now, but I pray that you guys would, that we would all enter in to that tender space where particularly God is asking us to release some things to him this morning with faith and humility.
Nothing I hold on to, nothing I hold on to.
place, God, would you release us to your will, Jesus, by your strength, Spirit, by your power. God, would you release us to your will? Your will for our lives is better than our will for our own. So we give that now as much as we can, and we trust you to do the rest. Amen. Please, let's have a seat.
Good morning, friends. So good to see you all. So grateful. I woke up this morning, I'm lying in bed, and I was just reflecting on what God is up to in our lives as a community, as individuals. I was just sitting there a moment ago and thinking of that phrase, you know, nothing is wasted with God. That we have such an interesting tapestry, this variegated reality that is represented in this room of different things that we're feeling. Some are in a season of consolation, some are in a season of desolation, and some are suffering deeply, some are experiencing rich blessing and joy, and it's all happening at once in the context of our community together. And to share that and to know that in all of those cases, God isn't wasting any of it. Any of it. The suffering, the hardship, the whatever. Nothing is wasted. So super grateful. We have, by the way, if you hadn't heard, a big chunk of us missing today. Whole crew from Grace headed down to Baja this weekend, is there now, probably heading back here shortly, I imagine, to build a church in the community of El Nino, and I think we have 60-plus people doing that, wielding hammers and hanging out with the kiddos down there in the neighborhood. So anyway, so good. I hope we didn't rain on them yesterday. That would not have been good, but... Anyway, we're grateful that we had the opportunity to do that. And there's something I wanted to mention to you guys. You know, from time to time, we'll have individuals within our community who are in need of a temporary place to stay, like a room or whatnot. And I was thinking, you know, last week we had Jim Williams and Caitlin Patton come up here and share with you about our new... ministry of Hands of Grace, which seeking to just meet many of the practical needs that we have within our community. And though this kind of thing doesn't happen, doesn't pop up that often, occasionally does, and I just thought I'd mention it on the heels of that announcement, that if any of you have an extra room or a place that you would like to make available for somebody just on a very temporary, short-term basis that may have a need, we just want you to be aware that we have people that are looking for that from time to time. And if that might be you, would you let us know? It's just another way, I think, we can care for each other here at Grace. And speaking of what God is doing, I'm so happy to have Moffat Zimba in the house. Moffat, will Doreen be here sometime today? Sometime today, yes. You know, we wanted to give Moffat the opportunity once again to update you about what God has been up to with Northrise University in Zambia, and he's going to come up in a minute. But you know, last night we had this lovely occasion to gather around many of the supporters of Northrise University to celebrate their 20th year anniversary, which is crazy to think about that. And so that was special. And in the course of that evening, they kind of recounted, you know, the story of kind of what led up to that. And Moffat's going to give you a kind of a more current update. But, you know, there's some people, I don't take it for granted that there's some of you maybe new to our community that don't know really a bit of the history. So give me a little bit of an opportunity to just share a few things, super abridged, but Moffat and Doreen grew up in Zambia, in Africa, and with very few resources and very few options, but found a way to get to a Bible college in Australia, bought a one-way ticket, $1,000 in their pocket. The $1,000 got burned in a month, and they had to depend on the Lord for their provision, and they've been depending on the Lord for their provision ever since, and God has provided in amazing ways. Something that was commented on last night, which really struck me, he said, we were really comfortable there, but we knew God was calling us to something bigger, a vision that was starting to brew in their minds about ministering to the needs of the people in Zambia, the students in Zambia, to build their lives so that they can make a difference in their own country, which led them to make the uncomfortable decision to leave comfort and go to U.S. and in California, and where Moffat got his doctorate at Fuller Seminary, and Doreen got her master's MBA in technology, and that's right when we met them. I couldn't remember the date. What was, you remember the year, Moffat, what that was when we first met you? 1997. They came to Grace. We fell in love with them instantly. They fell in love with us. And they started to come. They were living in L.A. at the time, or Pasadena, or wherever it was. And we asked him to come on staff. And so he served on our pastoral staff here at Grace for 6 years. So good. Just the consummate pastor. Amazing pastor heart. Pastor's heart. And then in 2003, and I remember this day. I don't know if it was 2003. I think it was 2003. Audrey McIntosh handed this dude a check for $100,000 to buy a building, a five-story building in downtown Indola. And that kind of like sparked, like, I guess we could do this now. And Audrey McIntosh, by the way, for those of you who don't know, she passed away. She was the one that purchased this building in 1994. And handed over the deed free and clear and said, here. So, amazing woman, and grateful for what God has done through her. Anyway, we took a group of 17 of us in 2003 to go to North Rise for the first time. This was a year, maybe a little less or so, before North Rise kicked off. And it was a big nothing, pretty much, except for that building. And they started with 50 students in 2004 and have 1,000 students now and some big things to come. But let me just say this. So that's a little history lesson. What a gift this has been to be a part of this story that God has been up to in Moffat and Doreen's life and through North Rise University. It's a remarkable story of faith and dependence and God's amazing, abundant provision, and one of the best things that has happened to our church. So anyway, Moffat, come on up. Give us an update.
Good morning. Good morning. I didn't hear you. Good morning. Well, this is the day that the Lord has made. We choose to rejoice in it. Amen. Amen. We can't relent. We need to follow Jesus. He's the author and perfecter of our faith. Nothing else beats the relationship we have with our God. And today, I just came Mark has already alluded to. I wanted to say thank you. Thank you to you as a church. You believed in us, and you embraced us. The first Sunday we were here, we had gone to one or two churches, three churches, and there was a little bit of warmth, but not warmth. And then when you came here, it was really warm. And the cue I took from my wife, Doreen, she says, we have to stay there. And when your wife is happy, then everything is okay. Do we have a PowerPoint presentation here? Well, 1990, first of all, in 1990, that's when we started off going to Australia. And God was so gracious to us. It was a journey of faith, and we can safely say God had to give us a one-way air ticket in order for us not to run back to Zambia. Because after 1 month, we would have gone back to Zambia. But he's gracious. And the leaders at Grace Fellowship Church, they said, we'll support you. We'll send you from home to home. So we told them, we said, how can you just write checks? You need to come and see. And that's how we took a trip in 2003, 17 of us. 2004, fast forward, we began classes. And today we celebrate our legacy, building our future. Jeremiah 29 verse 11 says, which is for all of us. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Jeremiah affirms that God is in control in everything. I have so many stories, but I just wanted to share two stories. Two stories of our students. When you look at that young man, Mlenga Msonda, you sponsored Mlenga Msonda. His dad was normal. He was, orphan. Now he's a big orphan. Mlenga did very well in IT. And we sponsored him to do a master's in information technology with Grand Canyon University. Mlenga is happily married to his wife, a medical doctor, Dr. Mwanga. But here's the thing. They are holding their baby, Ezra, priest, Ezra. Ezra will never go through what we went through and what Mlenga went through. Why? Because you educated Mlenga, and his life has changed forever. And he's the head of IT at North Rise University. This is the next level of leadership. Groomed them. Now they are our leaders. You did that. You have done that for over 800 students who have graduated. You, as Grace Fellowship Church. It's not how small the church is. It's how big the God is. The God you worship is bigger than all of us put together. The other one. This is Arising Life Ministries. Joyce graduated in 2009 from North Rise University with a Bachelor of Theology. Joyce had a heart for kids. North Rise would never reach out to the kids. But when we graduate someone, like a Joyce, she started a school, primary school from grade 1 to grade 7. She has 220 kids at her school. And today we have about 6 graduates from Arising Life who are at North Rise University doing IT, nursing, law, lawyers for Jesus, by the way. One life changes many. One life brings leadership to North Rise University. I can share so many things, but I want to say thank you. Thank you from my heart. You embraced us so much here. We felt comfortable. we felt at home. And we continue feeling at home. If there's a place in America, you know, there are four people who believed in us so strongly. One of them is Mark Page. Mark Page says, I will introduce you to my dearest friend who lives in Phoenix, and that was Dave Cheatham. Dave Cheatham introduced so many people in Phoenix and Texas. Bill Beck embraced all of you here. He introduced us to all of you here. Steve Bowie went out of this church and introduced us to so many people from Mariners Church. Four people can do wonders. And you have been praying for us. May the Lord bless you as we celebrate 20 years. It's our legacy, all of us. You sent a missionary from home to home, and your missionary has come back to report that the work you are doing is marvelous. It looks marvelous to the Lord, and we thank you. May his face shine on you. May he continue blessing you. You warm our hearts. And by the way, we'll be together in heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you.
So good. You have to let him tell you about what's in front of them at Northrise. It's really an amazing future. All the things that God has done in the past, we ain't seen nothing yet. So it's really exciting. Anyway, thank you for sharing that, Moffitt. Well, once again, we are pleased to have our good friend Rick Langer with us today. Rick is a familiar face for many of us around here. If you don't know Rick, he has been a professor of biblical studies and theology at Talbot at Biola University for the last, almost 19 years or something like that. Was a pastor at EV Redlands or EV Trinity, EV Free in Redlands for, 20 years or so before that. Rick has preached a number of times. He's spoken at our men's retreat. We are big fans of Rick. And rumor has it he's going to kind of land the plane, or I don't know if land the plane is lower the plane, and move to Colorado, where his family, some of his kids are, soon. So anyway, so happy to have Rick. Rick, by the way, many of you know this, wrote a couple books, Winsome Conviction and Winsome Persuasion. Amazing books, actually. Really love the subtitle for Winsome Persuasion, Christian Influence in a Post-Christian World, and the subtitle for Winsome Conviction, Disagreeing Without Dividing the Church. Not that relevant, but it was a really good... anyway, he has a lot of really good things to say, so Rick, thank you for being here. But before he comes up, why don't you open your Bibles to the book of James. We are in James 3 and verse 13, and our dear Linda Patton will be reading our passage today. Thanks, Linda.
Please stand for the reading of the Word. James 3, 13 through 18. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. This is the reading of the Word.
Thank you, Linda, and thank you, Grace. It's great to be here, great to be back here. This has been one of my favorite places to be. Moffitt and I share a common experience of having extremely warmly welcomed here at Grace Fellowship Church, and so thank you for that. It's fun to be back. In the words that you just heard, I would just like to kind of underscore the vision that James is offering at the end of that, and the fact that people would sow peace and in light of that reap a harvest of righteousness. And I worry that today we're not very good at doing that. And I think when we fail to sow peace, we don't have to worry very much about whether or not we'll get a harvest of righteousness, because we won't. There's really no other way to do it. So let me take a little bit of time to unpack that this morning. Let me begin by just reading a short, this is a little excerpt from a blog post that someone was writing, but it illustrates nicely the challenge that we face today. A family Thanksgiving dinner gone bad. All the kids and grandkids were at the house. It was quite a brood. We homeschooled our sons, cultivating strong critical thinking, literacy, adherence to biblical truth, and commitment to the founding doctrines of liberty and freedom. However, two sons' political leanings veered left, two remained conservative and libertarian, and one was somewhere in the middle. So I want you to picture, they got five sons, married, kids, grandkids, the whole package for Thanksgiving. It was a delightful Thanksgiving until it wasn't. A single loose comment, a snarky comeback, and suddenly a torrent of animosity erupted. One son stormed out of the dining room. Another took his kids outside to play. Pregnant wife ran outside sobbing and collapsed on a patio chair in the front yard. Their two-year-old daughter standing protectively beside her, patting her hand and saying, "It's going to be okay, Mommy. It's going to be okay." Eventually, my sons returned, avoiding eye contact with anyone. Soberly, each hugged his wife and said sadly, "Let's go home." The house was suddenly eerily quiet. I began straightening up, discovered forgotten stuffed animals, some teeny tiny socks, and a fraying blanket that was sure to be missed by bedtime. Was my close-knit family beginning to fray away as well? Our desire to speak the last word led us to speak angry words, and finally, not to speak to each other at all. This has been a concern for me, as Mark mentioned. I've written books about this. I've been working on this Winsome Conviction Project at Biola for the last 5 years. And it's interesting, as you read this story, this was not from a Christian website, by the way. This was from an organization that I've had some connections with, and they just, it's a, you know, not at all Christian in any particular way, but it has people who are Christians included, and clearly this woman was a very committed Christian, and I think all of her family members grew up Christian and have remained Christian. But the one thing they couldn't do is figure out not only how to disagree without dividing the church, they couldn't disagree without dividing the family. And you know what? That's not that common. But for all its commonness, it is no less tragic. And so, we're going to talk today a little bit about the tongue, about the way we talk to each other. And when you read the book of James, if you were to ask the question, does James think the tongue is good or evil? There's a very clear answer to that question, and the answer is yes. He thinks the tongue is good or evil and almost never neutral. It matters what we say. Very few of our words get a hall pass. Is the tongue good or evil? Yes. In light of that, choose wisely. Speak in what James describes, as we'll see shortly, using the wisdom from above rather than earthly wisdom. He writes this passage of scripture for those who want to sow peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. The alternative he describes is to sow selfish ambition and jealousy, and that will lead to disorder in every vile practice. Choose wisely. So let me begin by just unpacking a few things that are in the text. And first, I want to make a distinction between, a kind of a general distinction between wisdom and knowledge. And this passage is built around wisdom, as you've already seen. He's saying that wisdom is in effect proven by its results, and that it, and in that sense, it differs from mere knowledge. Here's one way to think about it. Knowledge enables you to get things done. Wisdom enables you to do good things. So knowledge is kind of a technology. It allows you to know how to do things and get something done. Wisdom guides you as to what you should do. Wisdom always has a moral valence. It's always pointing in some direction. And I want you to notice in this passage, James isn't contrasting wisdom and knowledge, but rather two different kinds of wisdom. That is, wisdom's the point in two different directions. And one of these is the way to get things done, knowing how to do your good. But unfortunately, the good is what you might call the demonic good. I mean, his language, not mine. He's just saying that's one way to operate. And there is a, quote, wisdom. It's not really wisdom. We all get that. But the point is there is a wisdom for getting that kind of result, and there's a wisdom for getting this other kind of a result that results in peace and in righteousness. And he's very concerned that we obviously do the right thing. Divine wisdom is a wisdom that can get things done that God thinks are good. Earthly wisdom, demonic wisdom, as James describes it here, gets things done that demons think are good, simply put. And this is what demonic wisdom gets done. It is a wisdom that comes not from above, but is earthly. It is unspiritual and demonic. Wherever there is jealousy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and every vile practice. Wow. And part of why I want to belabor this at the outset is to get a sense of the gravity that James attaches to this issue. He's really worried about this. I don't know how to get stronger language and to call it demonic. I think that's kind of a trump card, right? I mean, as bad goes, that's like bad, bad. That's really not what we want to do. Commentary gives a great description that says, the final result of such Satan-driven wisdom can only be disorder in every vile practice. Disorder in the Greek connotes a chaotic frenzy of fighting in the church or in the family. The Thanksgiving dinner that we just got, that was actually one of the interesting things about her description caught my attention. It was a chaoticness into which that wonderful, well-ordered, well-scrubbed Thanksgiving family celebration degenerated into. Why? Because of, in effect, demonic wisdom. So James is concerned, actually, throughout, not just here, but throughout chapter 3, most of chapter 4, about this issue of the tongue's power to create either good or evil, to accomplish what God thinks is good or Satan thinks is good. Quick observation about this. There's a tendency for us as evangelicals, we like right belief. We like truth. And so when we hear about being on God's side as opposed to somebody else's side, we're thinking the key thing is to get it right. It's a matter of the head. Accurately handling the word of truth, for example, from 2 Timothy chapter 2. So we believe that being on God's side is a matter of the head. And it's not less than that. But for James, he's most worried about the heart, it would appear. He wants the fruit of the Spirit, the fullness of the Spirit. He wants conversations and families and churches marked by love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's almost therapeutic to repeat. We should develop into a mantra, say to ourselves three times a day, morning, noon, and night or something, just to remind ourselves for what the concern is. James is very worried about the heart attitude, not just the head attitude. I've heard people say, well, I spoke my mind. Here's my observation. Yes, but you spoke your heart too. I'm just wondering if the two agreed. Because we have a knack for speaking the truth of God in a way that doesn't seem to correlate with the heart of God. It's hard to speak truth in a God-honoring way when you're pitching it in the key of animosity, anger, or division. So that's the threat that James is concerned about here. And by the way, this is not unique to James in the New Testament. 1 Corinthians 13 famously says, if I have all this knowledge, if I understand all mysteries, have all knowledge, but have not love, I'm a clanging cymbal. I'm chaotic noise. Ephesians 4 says we're to speak the truth in love. 1 Peter chapter 3 says to the non-Christian audience, always be ready to give them an answer, but deliver it with gentleness and respect. So in effect, as you read through the New Testament, you realize, oh, I can kind of go heretical in either of two ways. I don't want to get into technical discussion about what's a heresy, what's an apostasy, what's just abandoning Jesus. I don't care. The point is, whatever you want to call it, there's different ways we can depart from the path of Christ. You can deny the truth, or you can refuse love. Either way, you're rejecting part of the scripture. Either way, you're refusing to follow Jesus. And let me make a final comment about this relative to wisdom. It isn't so much that the goal here is to balance truth and love, and you need to figure out how to put these on the balance. Let me just say, wisdom is exactly the art of balancing truth and love. Getting it right and doing the good, the real good, the heavenly good. It is exactly that ability to figure out, how do I do both? Because of course there's times when simply saying what's true may be hurtful, but sometimes the hurt needs to happen. Sometimes saying what's true in a hurtful fashion is actually the last thing you need to do, and wisdom is the exact thing that needs to be cultivated in order to know which of the two you're doing in any given situation. So let me take a minute and unpack a little bit of what James says about this kind of wisdom that he describes with these wonderful words. The true wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. Let me just walk through some of those words. It's pure. The Greek word for this is a word that we often talk about with holiness, set apartness. It's the absence of a hidden agenda. I appear to be talking to you, and lo and behold, if you're pure, I really am talking to you. I'm not talking past you, I'm not advocating for some agenda, I'm actually talking to you. It's a purity, not just of, let me put it this way, it isn't simply undivided attention, it's also undivided intention. I'm truly focused on you. I am truly focused on that which is good. That is what I'm here talking about. In advancing my own agenda, not selfish ambition, as James describes it here, but a genuine, authentic concern for the good, purity, then peaceable. The notion here is one of wholeness, not brokenness. It's an interesting thing to think about. After you've had the conversation with a person, when you're done talking, are things more whole than they were when you started? Are they less divided or are they more divided? Do people feel more broken or less broken? Are you putting things together or blowing things apart? Shalom is that sense of bringing things together into right order with one another, the way things are supposed to be, it's sometimes translated. Gentleness, openness to reason. Are you willing to hear the other side? Are you willing to enter into the hearts and see through the eyes of others? And again, I think it's easy. If I was given this message 10 years ago and saying the things I'm saying, I'd be worried that you're all thinking this only applies to Christian relationships with the outside world, because, of course, we Christians agree with each other. What's happened in the intervening 10 years, I don't have to tell you, the agreements have moved inside, the disagreements have. And so very commonly, these are things we encounter within our families, within the church. So thinking about this, being open to reason, do I want to understand my fellow brother or sister in Christ? Let me be more direct. Do I want to understand my brother? Do I want to understand my literal sister? And by the way, I have one sibling who's a Christian, one sibling who is absolutely not a Christian. It's interesting. Do I want to love and care for one and not the other? All three of us have different opinions about any variety of things I might point out. But you know, they're my brother and sister. And I think it would be good to find ways to talk to them that preserve that sense of love and familiar connection. And in the New Testament, actually, the interesting thing is that the New Testament church practically replaces, in terms of the first claim, it doesn't remove familiar relationships, but the first claim on family is actually the brothers and sisters who share in common your new father, your father in heaven. So these are the kinds of things we're concerned about. And are you curious? Are you interested in this? I had an interesting experience with this. I had just spent a day moderating a workshop. In fact, I spoke here shortly before I did one of these, and some of you guys participated in this. It was a workshop with a group called Braver Angels, and they bring together right-leaning people and left-leaning people in exactly the same numbers, so you get kind of seven of each in this day-long workshop where you talk through a bunch of these political issues, and the goal is to seek mutual understanding. So I was the moderator of these things, did that for a few years, which was really a great experience. But I was, just after I'd done this one, it was actually the one that was down here in Costa Mesa that I did, I was going to a dinner at Talbot, and one of the students that I'd worked with, a graduate student, was there. He was asking what I was doing today. I said, well, I just told him. I said, well, this is what I did. And he looked at me, and he asked the question, if no one changes their mind, why do you bother doing it? And he wasn't trying to be mean. There was a bit of an edge, because that was a bit of his personality. But honestly, he was honestly asking, why do you do this if the only thing that happens is you talk better to each other and no one changes their opinion? And notice what is happening in that framework. All that matters is truth. Wouldn't it have been interesting to say, well, why do you do this if all that matters is at the end of the time people love each other more? I'm like, I don't know. Do I have to give an account if the result is that people love each other more? I mean, isn't that like a win? Isn't that a good thing? But when you only have eyes for the truth, if it's not the truth that you've won on, then you haven't won at all. And to broaden our horizon and say, I have sown peace today. I have sown peace today. And that's a good way to spend a Saturday. No complaints. No complaints. Did I change minds? I don't know. But I sowed peace. Full of mercy and good fruits, James writes. It'd be interesting to imagine a third party watching like an intense conversation you had with somebody at a coffee shop or something like that. And, you know, after you leave, the person comes up and asks the guy you were talking to, so what were they trying to sell you? What were they pushing? Would they say they were pushing mercy and good fruit? Is that what they were selling? Or were they selling something else? Impartial and sincere. This is a discipline, a that I have tried to cultivate because of bad experiences. Hey, learn from experience, right? And that is achieving disagreement. If you've heard me talk before, you may have heard me talk about this, but we think we disagree with people all the time. Here's the crazy thing. If I think I disagree with you and you were to ask me, so what does that guy think? And I were to say the following three things, here's the test with whether or not you have achieved disagreement. If that person were standing there, would he agree with your description of what he believes? Not only the facts, but the feelings about why they matter. And if the answer is no, you're like, that's not what I think. And then you often, you know, the bottom line is, if you don't know what he thinks, how could you possibly have achieved disagreement with him? Because you don't know what he thinks yet. You don't know how he feels and why he feels it. And so one of the great gifts that we give one another is the patience that it takes to be impartial and sincere, such that I could speak your viewpoint in a way you would look at it and say, that's right, you've done it. Thank you for the gift of impartiality and how you presented that, and sincerity in the way you spoke it. That's the vision of godly wisdom, being able to exercise that. It's not as fun as it sounds, by the way. You almost never get it right the first time if you bother checking. Now, the easiest way to avoid that is just don't bother checking. I like know that from experience, too. But anyhow, I recommend going all the way into this thing and saying, yeah, let me give it a whirl with a person in question. Here's what I hear you saying, and here's why this issue hurts you so much. You care so much about it, why it matters so much to you. That goes a long way to making things better. Now, having said this, I want to think a little bit about the best way to kind of put this into action if we really want to see this harvest of righteousness. And let me take, therefore, a brief aside and talk about my lawn. I realize you're probably anticipating this would turn into a lawn thing, right? No. So here's the deal. My first house was not in terrible shape house-wise, but the lawn, I mean, there's like neglect and then there's like botanical acts of violence. And that's what had happened to my lawn. I have no idea who perpetrated this tragedy, but it was an ugly scene. And it was now my lawn, not just like the neglected lawn in the neighborhood. So I happened to have a guy in the church who was one of the pioneers of sod farming. And so he and his uncle developed this machine in Indiana for, you know, growing sod and cutting it out, that little, you know, 2-inch little bit of dirt they get on the sod so they can plant it quickly. And, man, they were just, it was a big booming business. So he had done this whole thing. And I thought, who better to talk to than Don about how to solve this problem? And this guy is like Mr. Grow the Green Lawn dude. So I went and talked to him, and I began describing all my weeds and all the problem, but there was quite a collection. And he just starts shaking his head and says, Rick, stop talking about the weeds. He said, just fertilize the grass every holiday. Fertilize it on Easter, fertilize on Memorial Day, fertilize it on the 4th of July, fertilize it on Labor Day. Just make the grass grow and the weeds will take care of themselves. Well, now there's an interesting thought. I could tell you a few stories about my particular lawn and how that doesn't always work out perfectly. But that said, after 40 years of homeowning, I would say, you know, that was pretty darn good advice. Just make the grass healthy. And it's easy, once you get going on a passage like this and a lot of the stuff we do where we realize there really is evil, bad results, there's good results, we get focused on wanting to get rid of that which is bad. And I'd like to just flip the tables around for a few minutes here as I close and talk about the opposite. How do we have good conversations? How do we practice what I will call conversational hospitality? And my first instructor on this is a guy named Aylred, who wrote a book called Spiritual Friendships in about, I think it was 1098 AD. This is officially what we call a while ago. And it is a remarkably therapeutic book to read in the 21st century. And let me just begin by this observation. Again, notion here, conversational hospitality. How do we invite healthy, wholesome, peacemaking conversations into our lives and into the lives of those around us? So Aylward writes, not long ago, while I was relaxing among a crowd of brothers, on every side there was everyone was adding to the din. One was questioning, and another was debating. One was raising questions about scripture, another about ethics, a third about vices, a fourth about virtues. You alone were silent. By the way, the book is written as a dialogue, so he's talking to this monk. He is an abbot. He's talking to this monk who'd come to him to ask about friendship. You alone were silent. Suddenly raising your head up in the group, as you were about to add some remark, your voice seemed to stick in your throat. Then lowering your head, you fell silent, withdrawing a short distance from us, but then again returning, you looked crestfallen. From all this, I was led to conclude that hating crowds and preferring privacy, you hesitated to express what was on your mind. Now, this is an introductory paragraph to what follows, but I thought, wow, what a keen insight. The first thing I want to point out is that Aylred, the abbot in this story, had an eye for those around him. He wasn't thinking about who was winning the argument. He was worried about what was happening to the people in the room. And he saw this one monk withdrawing, feeling excluded, not included. That monk was not experiencing in that moment conversational hospitality. He wasn't being welcomed in. And so Aylward goes on and says, now, talking to this brother still, now no one else is present to disturb the peace or interrupt our friendly conversation. No voice, no noise invades our pleasant retreat. You and I are here, and Christ is between us as a third. Yes, most beloved brother, open your heart now and pour whatever you please into the ears of a friend. Gratefully let us welcome the time, the place, and the leisure for a conversation. There's something just beautiful about that passage. And I'd like to just make a couple comments on the things that Aylred identifies there. One is this whole image of undivided attention that he offers to this person. When no one else was paying attention to them, Aylred looked at this person and said, I wonder what's going on in his heart, in his soul, in his mind. How could I welcome him to come and share that? No noise, nothing invades our pleasant retreat. David Benner is a guy who writes on spiritual formation stuff, some good books, and he talks about soul hospitality, and I'm kind of tweaking some of this to conversational hospitality, but he talks about preparing your soul like you prepare a house for visitors. Soul hospitality is taking another person into my space, into my life, to be a soul friend. Soul holes prepare the gift of hospitality by cultivating a place of quiet within themselves, a place where they can receive others. If I have no such place within myself, I am unable to offer the gift of soul hospitality to others. But as I learn to be a person with a quiet center, I can invite others to come and rest there. It is out of the quiet place that we offer the gifts of presence, stillness, safety, and love. There are certain things that we have in our culture today that are absolutely inimical to developing a quiet space within our own hearts. I mean, we point the finger a lot at social media. I've thought about this a fair bit, and I've decided it deserves it. Okay, there you go. But I will get Fox News sometimes. I don't watch it a lot, but I get it in the workout room at Biola and some other places, and I'm like, wow, this is angry. And then I'll go to a different place, and I'm watching MSNBC. And I'm like, yeah. And then I bumped into a friend of mine. I stayed at their house, And they had this on, I won't bother telling you which of the two channels, but they had it on 24 hours a day. And let me just ask, what does that do to the quiet places in your soul? I'm not even worried about who's right and who's wrong in the network wars. I'm just saying, what does it do to your ability to offer the gift of quiet welcome to another human being? It's just devastating. And at some point, we have to decide, what are we going to pay attention to? What are we going to click on? Paul has this wonderful teaching about this in Philippians chapter 4. Whatever is pure, whatever is good, whatever is tried, whatever is noble, whatever is worthy of praise, whatever is excellent, click on these things when you're on the internet. You know the last things, I mean, statistically, when they do the studies, the last things we click on are whatever is good, whatever is noble, whatever is pure, whatever is excellent, whatever is worthy of praise does not merit a click. And let me just suggest to go counterculture. Click on some good stuff. Feed the quiet place in your soul that you might be able to feed others by extending the gift of a quiet place of conversational hospitality to them. Secondly, uninterrupted time. One of the great gifts we give one another is not just conversation, but time for conversation. I remember and can think back fondly to certain moments in my own life that I just treasure, and many of these are multi-hour conversations. I had three friends who were both very, very kind of high-powered business guys. Well, two of them and then me, who's like, not. But we would get together, and we would, because of their schedules in particular, we would just set aside, we're going to meet at noon, and we'll finish when we're done. I would say on average those meetings took 9 hours, about 3 hours apiece. And it's some of the greatest gifts I've ever been given, particularly these guys. If you were to count their how much is money worth, or time worth to me in money? The answer was a lot. And they gave me 9 hours. We gave each other 9 hours of undivided attention. An incredible gift. And it doesn't have to be that long, but it is an impressive thing to be willing to pay one of the most expensive things we can, which is paying attention. Undivided, uninterrupted attention to another heart or soul. And then the absence of an agenda, as Aelred describes it. Yes, most beloved, open your heart now and pour whatever you please into the ears of a friend. Another thing that I've done with small groups sometimes on this, it's proven to be really invaluable, is to just say, okay, we're going to take the rest of the afternoon or evening, I've done these on retreat kind of settings, and just say, okay, imagine you're at the mall, and there's one of those maps, and they have, you know, the map of the whole thing, and then there's this little dot that says, you are here. Let's let everyone have a chance to tell the story of you are here on the life, the mall map of your life, so to speak. Where are you? What's going on, and what really matters in your heart and soul. Just a cautionary term on this, once you really invite people to tell those stories, it takes a ton of time. I'd done this first with a very small group. It was such a wonderful time. I had a group of like 11 people. I thought, let me start this retreat with that. The entire rest of the evening was gone, and it took the first half of the morning before they finished. But they gave each other the gift of undivided attention to the souls of one another without a big agenda. It wasn't out of bounds to talk about politics, but it wasn't particularly in bounds either. The point is, talk about what's on your heart. Let us be the people who welcome and invite you to share that. So let me just conclude by offering a quick reminder on this. And that is that you can sow in either of two kinds of wisdom. He can sow in demonic wisdom, hoping to gain demonic goods, things like division, strife, animosity, or you can practice the wisdom from above and pursue that which is pure, that which is peaceful, that which is open to reason, impartial and sincere, full of mercy and good fruits. Both of them work, so to speak. They produce their own fruit. But choose wisely. Choose well. And seek to produce the wonderful fruit and the harvest of righteousness that comes from it that God promises. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We do thank you for the gift of the tongue. And as we pointed out, it almost always is good or evil, almost never neutral. So Lord, help us to be wise in our words. Help us to love what is good, and help us to love one another by extending them the gift of conversational hospitality and welcome. And we ask this now in Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Rick. It's good. Always good to have you. All of this by the power of our God, not by our own, right? Hard stuff. But really only one way to go if we're following his will. Why don't we stand and let's sing these last couple of songs and reinforce some of these things we've been hearing about this morning. And use this time to pray that God does this for you. And there are people in the back and on the side, Jim's over here, who would love to pray with you also if you want to extend some time in specific prayer. But let's sing this together. What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and free, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to Him. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not but through Christ. every breath I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home, and day by day I know he will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I when the race is complete, yours will it be, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ. In the crushing and in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. In the crushing, in the crushing, you are breaking new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you and to your careful hand. When I trust you, in the pressing, you are making new wine. Oh, in the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. And so I yield to you and to your careful hand. Oh, when I trust, change in our lens, in our perspective, God, in our effort to bring righteousness and peace and healing and words of blessing. God, make us a vessel for that. As we sing this, God, let this be our prayer. We love you and we serve you. Here's our confession. Here's our request. Make me a vessel. Let's sing this. Amen.
Make me a vessel and make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came.
Bless this people. Bless this morning, God. Amen. God bless you as you go. Keep the thought in your mind of being a blessing with your tongue. Amen. Amen.
See you.